Watch out! All fighters away from the flagship.
What? The floor!
If they attack Saki from the air, then we'll need this.
What the? All fighters break apart.
Hello everybody, my name is Dalton Nelson and today I'd like to give my thoughts on a game I just beat. That game being Sin and Punishment for the Nintendo 64. Sin and Punishment was developed by Treasure and published by Nintendo. It is a 3D third-person on-rails shooter. Treasure, legendary developer, responsible for some of my favorite games this year, such as Mischief Makers and Ikaruga, as well as one of my all-time favorites, Gunstar Heroes. At this point, Treasure almost doesn't need an introduction. They've got top-quality titles throughout their gamography. Now, throughout the year, I've been making a conscious effort to play most of Treasure's catalog, and I've gotten a good chunk out of them thus far. Although, sooner or later, I would have to go to Treasure's Japanese exclusive titles if I wanted to complete their catalog. Most of these games are licensed, so I'm not too worried about it. Although, one game in particular is on every Nintendo 64 import gamer's mind, and that's Sin and Punishment. Sin and Punishment came out very late in the Nintendo 64's lifespan in Japan, so it makes sense why it never made it here. Although, as a result, if you want to play it now, you don't have many options. Sin and Punishment used to be available for Americans on the Wii Virtual Console, although that has since been shut down. And then there's buying the game legitimately, and just switching out the Japanese back for an American cartridge back. Although, if you want to do that, that is going to run you more than just a pretty penny. Which leaves emulation, which is probably the most practical way of going about playing this game until it becomes officially available again, whenever that would be. Personally, I was given a multi-cart by my buddy Tyler, shout out, that had an English text translation of this game on it. And after playing Sin and Punishment, we really missed out. This game is pretty amazing. The whole game is one action-packed experience from start to finish. My first time playing through the game felt like sensory overload. Sin and Punishment is very easy to pick up and play. The controls are very simple. You can either use the camera buttons or the directional pad to move your character from side to side. The control stick is used to aim your reticle, which is where your shots will go. Holding the Z button down will automatically fire shots at a high fire rate. You can also double jump as well as dodge to the side, making movement of the character part of dodging incoming enemy shots. The dodge is executed by hitting a side button twice in succession. And with the Nintendo 64 controller, it can be a little awkward to pull off, but if you can do it, you'll be rewarded with some frames of invincibility, as well as a good sized length of a dodge. Sin and Punishment also has two modes of firing. There is a free shot mode, where you move the reticle freely and your shots deal higher damage. And then there is a auto lock-on mode, where the reticle will automatically lock on to targets if you have the trouble of aiming in free shot mode. Although, these shots deal weaker damage. I love this inclusion of options for different levels of players. This is something Treasure has always done ever since Gunstar Heroes, so this really shouldn't be surprising, but I am still very thankful that they think so much of their players in this way. Sin and Punishment also works in multiple planes here. In addition to moving your character on the X and Y axis with jumping and moving, there is also a little bit of complexity going on in the Z axis in terms of mechanics. Specifically, what I am referring to here is the melee attack you can pull off if anything gets too close to you. If you hit the button when an enemy is on or close to the plane your character is on, your character will slice the enemy with massive damage with their sword attack. You can also deflect attacks right back at enemies with this move, if you time it right, also dealing massive damage. These actions themselves are very simple to pull off in execution, but this, combined with how well Sin and Punishment uses character movement, also provides a little more complexity to the on-rail shooter not seen in Sin and Punishment's contemporaries, like House of the Dead. The structure of the game itself is split into multiple levels, most of which feature a large shooting section with bosses interlaced in between them. Despite how busy the game may look, Sin and Punishment does give the player some time to breathe, so the game never feels exhausting to play. Some of these levels can be weaker than others. The fight with the crawfish steamer comes to mind, as well as the second to last level of the game. These levels can be a little tougher to get through. I didn't care for them as much as other levels. I also thought that some of the boss strategies could be a bit too cryptic, like Radahn, who you have to melee attack off the edge, or Leda's fight, which involves more melee attacks and deflection mechanics. If you give these bosses some time, and through trial and error, you will figure out what you have to do. I just wish it was a little bit more clear. As a whole, Sin and Punishment is an amazingly energetic experience, and it's short too. My first complete playthrough of the game took me about an hour and a half, and now I can complete the game in 45 minutes with no deaths on easy difficulty. With this length and the fantastic soundtrack that accompanies this game, Sin and Punishment almost feels like you are playing through a Japanese action kaiju movie, with twists and turns and creatively designed monsters. And the game caps off with what is probably the coolest and craziest boss fight I've ever been a part of. Seriously, Sin and Punishment is worth playing through just to see this thing. It's glorious. You can definitely tell playing through this game that Hiroshi Yuichi and Atsumoto Nakagawa were behind this project. These guys are the pair who also worked on Ikaruga in the spare time they had while developing this game. There are a few things to note here for Sin and Punishment that may be divisive depending on what kind of player you are. The story of the game is crazy and fast-paced, but it forgets to convey some important information to the player. Who, what, where, when, and why kind of fall by the wayside, as the game is quick to jump right into the action. I do like the story of the game, but given that I harshly criticized a game recently for the same problems, it would be unfair not to bring it up here. I definitely recommend you go online and read a little bit of background for Sin and Punishment's story before you get into it. I am starting to notice that this is a common problem that Treasures games have. Even Gunstar Heroes has this problem a little bit. There is also the voice acting, which I think is charming, but it's not great. There are tons of awkward line deliveries here, and some of the actors sound younger than the characters they're playing. I think overall some better direction here would have helped the actors sound a little bit more natural. But overall, Sin and Punishment is another fantastic entry in the Treasure Library. It does not fail to entertain, and is worth the hype that surrounds it. So I'm going to give it a final score of a 7 out of 10. You should definitely make an effort to play Sin and Punishment at some point in your life. I know that it might be a little bit more troublesome than buying another game digitally on a modern storefront, but I say go for it. Sin and Punishment deserves your attention. That concludes my review for Sin and Punishment. If you like my reviews, you can like, comment, or subscribe. I also have social media links down in the description below, as well as a link to my online portfolio where you can see video game works that I have done. And with that out of the way, please make sure to have a nice day!